So as long as you are sitting in Bhagavad Gita sessions, please do this chant every single day. Om Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kamsa Chanuramardhanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagat Gurum Om Vasudeva Sutam Devam Kamsa Chanuramardhanam Devaki Paramanandam Krishnam Vande Jagat Gurum. Read the meaning of the chant here. I salute unto you Bhagavan Krishna, Guru, Master of the World, Son of Vasudeva, Supreme Bliss of Devaki, Destroyer of Kamsa and Chanura. I salute to you. That's what it means. Now, yesterday we were speaking about how life is an expansion, the art of listening, how Krishna became a listener when Arjuna was speaking. Throughout the first chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Arjuna was going on speaking and Krishna was listening and listening and listening. Please understand, when you listen to others, you listen to yourself. Only when you listen to you, you will be able to listen to others. When you listen to others, you will also listen to you. Please understand, any listening that happens from the space of completion. You can only listen when you are complete. If there is any incompletion in you, you will not be able to listen. So that is the essence we were speaking yesterday. And also, the summary. By his very listening, Sri Krishna, Bhagavan, is able to heal the restlessness in Arjuna, the incompletions in Arjuna. And Krishna is showing that. He's showing us the power of his completion, the power of his listening. He just listens while Arjuna empties himself. He allows Arjuna to speak into his pure listening. That's what I told. Now the real Gita can start. Now the real Gita starts. How? With Arjuna's root pattern. Discussing about Arjuna's root pattern. See, please understand, this whole Bhagavad Gita, what we are doing, it's not just to listen to some book, no. It is for us to learn the important truths which Krishna is trying to tell us, how to deal with our life every day, how to deal with our patterns every day. That is why we are doing the Gita, right? Please understand, when Krishna listens to Arjuna, he is interested in Arjuna's real problem, not what Arjuna is complaining about. He is not interested in just expressing what he knows. See, Arjuna is complaining about something, but that's not his real problem. Something else is his real root pattern. So Krishna is not interested in just expressing what knowledge he has. No. He wants to allow Arjuna to speak, then listen into Arjuna, and then give the solution for the real problem. That is why he allows Arjuna to speak into his listening, so that he can go to the root of the problem and address the issue. He knows that once he allows Arjuna to express his problems, Arjuna himself can find a solution to them. That is what Krishna is trying to do. And naturally, Arjuna continues to speak. He exposes the root of his problem, his root thought pattern, when he's continuing to speak, what will happen? Naturally, his root pattern will be exposed, isn't it? That's what happened. What is the root thought pattern? See, please understand. If you understand the root thought pattern of somebody, you will also understand the root thought pattern of yours. If you understand the root pattern of yours, that is when all the incompletions, how they actually branched, how they actually born, you will understand. So to have the right understanding about root pattern, we are discussing this. The first strong cognition you receive in your life, which influences you to continue to function based on the same cognition, is a root thought pattern. Understand, what is root thought pattern? The first strong cognition you receive in your life, which influences you to continue to function based on the same cognition, is a root thought pattern. That is exactly what we had at our very young age, which is controlling us even today, controlling all our decisions. Please understand. It is the pattern you develop when powerlessness takes you over for the first time in your life. It is the pattern you develop when powerlessness takes you over for the first time in your life. When powerlessness takes over you for the first time in your life, your pure cognition is imbalanced and your mind is born. Got it? Listen, the way you behave, feel, and respond all come from this root thought pattern. It is the limiting cognition that happens in you and fills you at a very young age, overpowering you. Sometimes it is fear. Sometimes it is greed. Sometimes it is jealousy. And sometimes it is the decision to prove yourself. Sometimes it is just plain confusion and worry. Throughout the initial chapters of the Gita, Arjuna is operating out of his root thought pattern, his parental and societal conditioning, struggling with all the do's and don'ts that he learned from society. The moment he sees that the enemy he has to fight are his own extended family, he is overcome by powerlessness and refuses to fight. He's complaining. Swajanam, swajanam means my people in the chants of the first chapter he keeps saying swajanam, swajanam means my people the bonds of family were rooted in his very identity, and to Arjuna to cut these bonds was like destroying himself. This was Arjuna's dilemma, conflict. You understood? Listen carefully, the whole context. You will understand how we are operating in our life. He was overcome by powerlessness and refused to fight. Not because he's compassionate and he refused to fight. You understood? It came from a very powerless space, where the bonds of family were rooted in his very identity. And to cut this identity roots, he felt as though he is destroying himself. It is here that the Gita begins. Because Krishna finally begins to speak. In the succeeding chapters of the Gita, Krishna compassionately guides Arjuna, releasing him from his root thought pattern, guiding him to completion, and leading him to the ultimate knowledge, the knowledge of the self, Atma Jnana, knowledge of the self. Arjuna is re-established in Jivan Mukti, living enlightenment, the space of living Advaita. The way Swamiji decodes everything, all the mystery lying behind the verses, how he just puts it in front of us. It's such simpleness, isn't it? Now let us go into understanding Sri Krishna's teachings through the four tattvas. That is when each chapter, each verse is uttered, you will understand how to connect it to our life. Right? So let us understand the essence of Krishna's teachings through the four tattvas. Through the four tattvas. See, Krishna's teachings in the Gita can be understood through four simple but powerful universal principles. The four tattvas: integrity, authenticity, responsibility, and enriching. These four principles awaken the four innate great powers within us. Integrity, sampurti, is you fulfilling the word and thought you give to yourself and to others and experiencing a state of purnatva, completion with yourself and with life. That is integrity. What is authenticity, which Krishna is talking about, is you being established in the peak of your capability and responding to life from who you perceive yourself to be for yourself, who you project yourself to be for others, and what others expect you to be for them. Are you getting my point? Here comes the inner image, outer image, others' image. You got it? See, we think something about ourselves to ourselves, but we show ourselves to others in a different way, something else. And from whatever we are projecting, others will perceive something else totally about us. So on the whole, because of all these three things, we perceive life in another way. So all these four things have gaps. So, as being established in peak of our capability and responding to life with all these images, that is authenticity. Without a gap in between all these images, if we are able to respond, that is authenticity. Responsibility, the third tattva, upayana, is living and responding to life from the truth that you are the source of, and therefore you are responsible for all happenings in and around you. Somebody else is not to be blamed. You are responsible. Enriching, fourth principle, apyayanam. Enriching it is you taking responsibility with integrity and authenticity, that you are committed continuously enriching. You are committed to continuously enriching, which is expanding yourself and life in and around you. Because the life in us, the life which is outside us, the life in others, everything is one and the same. It is not different, isn't it? Even though we call people as others, actually it is not others. The life in them and the life in us is one and the same. So any problem or conflict you have in your life, actually it can be handled very practically, efficiently, and skillfully with these four principles. See, Swamiji says, with his entire experience, that these four principles are the essence of all spiritual scriptures, because they are the essence of life. Literally, essence of life. Please understand, these four spiritual principles awaken four great inner powers in you. Each tattva is the key to unlock a corresponding power in you. Now I will reveal these four inner powers that manifest when Krishna's message is internalized and lived. Listen, you actually have the power to simply manifest the reality of your choice. Many times we feel everything is impossible, right? Whether you know it or not, whether you believe it or not, in each one of you, there is an enormous potential energy that expresses as four great powers. To be able to unlock these great powers inside you, you must first understand a little more about yourself. They are related to the four major dimensions of your life. Only then, every word what Arjuna is saying, every solution what Krishna is giving, you will be understanding in a different plane. In each one of us, there's an enormous potential energy that expresses as four great powers. To be able to unlock these great powers inside us, we must first understand a little more about ourselves. They are related to the four major dimensions of our life. Please understand, there are four major dimensions. Our words, our thinking, our emotions, and our living. When we awaken our peak possibility in each of these dimensions, it becomes a great power and support in our life. These four inner powers are the power of words or vak shakti. The power of words will be available to you when you practice integrity. The power of words will be available to you when you practice integrity. The power of thoughts or mano shakti, the power of thinking, will be open to you when you practice authenticity. The power of feeling or prema shakti, the power of feeling will be possible when you practice responsibility. The power of living or atma shakti, the power of living will be established in you the moment you enrich others. Now, please understand, integrity is the strategy for success. Listen, your words are your life. Integrity is the key that unlocks the power of words. Your words are your life. We all know honesty. You know, honesty is more like ethics, morality. But with the tattva of integrity, you are taking a step deeper than honesty. With honesty, you only have to honor the words that you give to the others, right? Honesty means what? Honoring our words that we give to others. But with integrity, you also have to honor the words that you give to yourself. Honesty is not integrity. Integrity is honesty also. But honesty is not integrity. Integrity is honesty as well as something more. It's very unfortunate that society teaches you to honor the words that you give to others, but forgets to teach you to honor the words that you give to yourself. The words you give to yourself are as important as or more important than the words you give to others. Because the flow of your life, the amount of contentment that you feel in your life, the degree of fulfillment that you feel in your life, and the experience of fulfillment that you feel in your life, everything depends on the words that you have given to you. Please understand, the words you give to yourself, it forms the bone structure of your life. If you commit with yourself that you will become a doctor and you don't honor that word and you don't even bother to complete the word inside your heart, then that word hangs inside you as a broken commitment given by you. Please understand, integrity is you not carrying the hangover of the commitments you have made, either to yourself or to others. When you break the commitments you give to you, what will happen? You will lose self-confidence. The more commitments you give and break, the more your self-confidence is lost. You lose confidence in you completely. When you break the commitments you give to others, it takes away their confidence in you. That is different. Please understand. When you break commitments to others, it will take away their confidence on you. That is different. But if you break your words to yourself, you will lose confidence on you. That is the worst thing. That is the worst thing ever, I tell you. When you don't honor the words you give and don't even bother to complete with them, the broken commitments that hang in your heart take away your self-confidence in life. This is what happens to Arjuna on the battlefield. Please understand. What happened to Arjuna on the battlefield? He lost self-confidence on life. Why? Because he stopped honoring the words he gave to himself and didn't bother to complete with them. Arjuna is a Kshatriya by birth, a warrior, a Pandava prince. When the Pandavas decide to wage war against their Kaurava cousins, Arjuna is perfectly aware that this includes a large part of his extended family. Am I right? When he took the declaration, he already knows that the other side, opposite side, is having large part of his extended family. Yet, he made the decision to fight as per his dharma, his righteousness, as per his path, as a Kshatriya. But when he enters the battlefield, he only sees friends, teachers, uncles, relatives leading the army, and he forgot to see the evil men who snatched away his kingdom and publicly insulted his brother and wife. He got caught in the clutches of his parental conditioning. So Arjuna instantly becomes powerless. He didn't honor his own words, his own dharma. He became powerless. And he decides to leave the battlefield. Please understand, every decision we make, with full awareness of all the advantages and disadvantages we make. He is aware that extended family is there. Then why he decided to fight? He already decided. He felt that is his dharma as a Kshatriya. Now, after going there to the battlefield, he is seeing only ayo friends, ayo uncles. Means inside he stopped honoring his own words. That is when he became powerless. He lost self-confidence. He lost confidence on life itself. Are Krishna, incarnation, sitting with him. And he lost confidence on life. By trying to escape from the battle, Arjuna falls completely out of integrity with his dharma as a warrior. This is what is happening in the first chapter. Arjuna falls completely out of integrity with his dharma as a warrior. He has slipped from his dharma as a Kshatriya. As a Kshatriya, he should have fulfilled the words he gave to himself, to his family, to his master. And he should have had the courage to face his decision of waging war against the Kauravas. Otherwise, he should not have taken the decision for war. But by becoming powerless and preparing to leave the battlefield, Arjuna is out of integrity with his dharma. And that non-integrity will have consequences, isn't it? Because that non-integrity gives a certain consequence, we call it as sin. It is, see, self-denial, self-doubt, everything comes out of this non-integrity only, no? Losing confidence, escaping, all that. See, understand? See, in a way, not facing the truth and becoming powerless is also root pattern only, actually. One of the root patterns. we'll be having two or three, no? It's not like only one root pattern is there. So being out of integrity with our own dharma, naturally it becomes a root pattern inside us. So this is what happens when we function out of our root pattern. We fall out of integrity with the words we give to ourselves and others, and the root pattern takes over your response to life. When we fall out of integrity, the root patterns like fear or greed or, you know, all these kind of things will take over us. It takes over and we will respond in a certain way to life. Understand? Taking responsibility for your words is practicing dharma, the right living. In Mahabharata, dharma is defined as, do not do unto others that which would cause pain when done to you. This is the essence of dharma. Suppose you are feeling everybody has to trust you. But you have a pattern of not trusting anybody. Is it fair? I will not trust anybody, but please everybody trust me. Will that work like that? It won't work like that, no. Please understand. Whatever causes you pain, don't give the same pain to others. So, the essence of dharma is, do not do unto others that which would cause pain when done to you. One principle, see, every person, if we have one principle, it's enough, no. If we follow that, it will lead, all the other tattvas also will follow you. See, the only way to come out of lack of integrity is through completion. Please understand, through his dialogues with Arjuna on the Sankhya Yoga and Karma Yoga, means there are different chapters, the nature of life and the purpose of action, Krishna helps Arjuna find the right understanding to complete with the limiting cognition created by his root thought pattern. Please understand, Sankhya Yoga, the chapter, it speaks about the nature of life. The Karma Yoga, that chapter, speaks about the purpose of action. Through all these Gita, Krishna is trying to help Arjuna find the right understanding to complete with the limiting cognition created by his root thought pattern. See, Krishna teaches Arjuna two key concepts. Nityam means the nature of the eternal. And na tvam sochitu marhasi means the pointlessness of grieving. By revealing to Arjuna the truth about his true eternal self, Krishna helps him with the right understanding to go beyond all the arguments of his logic and complete with his root pattern. Arjuna then awakens his power of words that brings him the spontaneous intelligence and the clarity to use the right words to verbalize his real self-doubts. Many times for fun, every day in our life, we utter so many words. You don't know what it's doing to us. First, it's very important to use the right words inside and to verbalize the right words outside. So Arjuna's initial powerless words of grief, such as, oh Madhusudana, how can I oppose Bhishma and Drona in the battle who are worthy of my worship? This is one of the chant meaning. First, what did he say? Oh Madhusudana. He's calling Krishna as Madhusudana. How can I oppose Bhishma and Drona? Bhishma is his forefather. Drona is his guru, who are on the opposite side on the battlefield. He's telling, they are worthy of my worship. How can I oppose them, O Krishna? He's justifying his powerlessness by using all these reasons. See, his initial powerless words of grief. See, Krishna teaches Arjuna two key concepts. Nityam means the nature of the eternal. And the pointlessness of grieving. These are the two concepts which he gave. Nature of the eternal means he revealed to Arjuna the truth about his true eternal self. And Krishna helps him with the right understanding to go beyond all the arguments of his logic. Before hearing to this Krishna, what Arjuna was telling, how can I oppose Bhishma and Drona, whom I should worship? Now his words turned into inquiry, such as, what are the descriptions of the steady one who is merged in the awareness of truth and wisdom? He is asking now. Before Krishna completed him, he was saying, how can I oppose Bhishma? After Krishna completed him with the science of completion, now what Arjuna is telling? His argument became an inquiry. What is he inquiring now? What are the descriptions of the steady one, means steady person, who is merged in the awareness of truth and wisdom? How does that kind of a person speak? How does that kind of a person sit? And how does that kind of a person walk? Now Arjuna is ready for the next lesson. These are the first verses in which Arjuna questions Krishna. Now Krishna gives the answer. The integrity itself will teach the right words. It will teach the right questions. It will give the right answers. And it will put you on the right path. That's all. It's not like he is only talking about power of words and how to be integrated. That's all. When you are in integrity, that not being emotional or not having restlessness will automatically happen. You don't have to do anything about it. It's not about not doing anything. It is about restlessness leaving you. You should not control that. It will leave you when you are in integrity. You are getting my point, right? See, all these qualities like fear or guilt or restlessness or anxiety or emotions, they should leave you. All you need to do is just be in integrity. That's all. In the first place, even the pain which we have, how to deal with it comes later. But in the first place, when we are integrated to our words and actions and thoughts and everything, this pain itself will never happen for you to even handle. That's all. The pain itself will not happen for you to handle in the first place. See, you will handle it only after it happens to you, right? But what Swamiji Krishna is saying here is, when you are in integrity, that never even happens. There is no first being honest and then coming to the point of integrity. It's not a journey. Please understand. First you will become honest. Then you will go to the space of integrity. It is not a journey towards integrity. It's a matter of just decision. Means, right now, this moment, you can become integrated. It's not like, first you will be honest to yourself, then you will become integrated, then it will take you to the point of integrity. That means what? We are thinking that honesty is here, first we will become honest, then this will lead us to integrity. No, it's not like that. Once the decision is happening in the present moment, you honoring it is integrity. That's all. So decision happens in the present moment. It's not going to take you somewhere else, right? Seema, even if suppose you're feeling some kind of suffering inside, you just going through that at that moment as it is integrity only. So as you are looking at it with awareness, it will drop on its own then and there. see, you are calling that awareness with different names. Either you call it integrity, either you call it completion, either you call it unclutched, either you call it enlightenment, either you call it pure listening, whatever names you give, that total awareness, that bliss, being established in that space completely. You can call it anything you want. You can call it unclutched, you can call it completion, you can call it pure listening, you can call it as pure authenticity, anything you can call. Names are different, that's all. Understand me? Because a person who is 100% in authenticity is already enlightened. That is the best part of these principles, is once you start honoring it, it will overtake you, it will take over you, and it will make you follow. That's the beauty of this integrity and authenticity and all. Anyhow, so Arjuna is now asking, after the completion is over, he is asking, now it turned into inquiry. His powerlessness turned into inquiry. He is asking, oh Arjuna, oh Madhusudana, a person who is established, who is stable, who is steady, how does he walk? How does he talk? That person who is merged in the truth of awareness, how does he speak? He's asking. Now Arjuna is ready for the next lesson.